mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. The chapter of our gospel that John read to us tonight comes from the second part of Mark's gospel, which chronicles the beginning of Jesus' final journey to Jerusalem. And in today's gospel, an unnamed man approaches Jesus and inquires about what he must do to inherit eternal life. Jesus replies that one must follow the commandments and the law of Moses. Now this man says that he has observed all of these since his childhood. Then it's lovely, isn't it, because it says that Jesus looks upon the man with love. And then says that only one thing is lacking. He must give his possessions to the poor and follow Jesus. We have to, I think our lives are spent trying to be able to speak the truth with love. And you just have to follow Jesus and notice how he's able to do that. The man leaves in sadness. And Mark tells us that this is because he had many. Now, the belief in resurrection and eternal life was a relatively recent development in Jewish thought at the time of Jesus, and it wasn't shared by everyone. The Pharisees taught that there would be resurrection from the dead, but the Sadducees didn't share this belief. Jesus taught that there would be a final judgment for everyone, and eternal life, the kingdom of God, for believers. Throughout history, some Christians have taken this literally. Their example witnesses to us a radical commitment to the gospel of Jesus. Some have read this as a particular requirement directed to this particular person. Still others have tried to explain the meaning intended by the word possessions as those things that prevent us from following Jesus. Christians have generally understood that at the least, following Jesus needs believers to hold material possessions loosely and remain vigilant against seeking security from accumulating possessions. Now the second requirement that Jesus makes of this man is the invitation that he extends to us all, follow me. Jesus very much wants this man to be his disciple. We believe that the Christian faith is one in which each believer is in a personal relationship with Jesus. And just as the gospel tells us that Jesus loves this man and is sad when he departs, so too, Jesus loves us and is saddened when we're unable to follow him. To his disciples, Jesus laments the challenges faced by those who are rich in following him and entering the kingdom of God. And in reply to their astonishment at the strictness of the standard that Jesus speaks about, he reminds his disciples that nothing is impossible with God. In other words, he's not expecting us to be able to do that in our own strength. So Salvation is determined by our ability to rely completely upon God. Peter replies to Jesus by boasting that the disciples have already given up everything. And Jesus acknowledges that those who have given up everything for the sake of the gospel will be rewarded. And this reward begins now, in the new community that we will gain in this life, and will continue in the eternal age to come. Our personal relationship with Jesus is also an invitation to the community of faith, the church. Now, today's gospel might make us feel uncomfortable about our possessions, but it offers us the opportunity to consider our possessions and perhaps our commitment and our family's commitment to the poor. Material possessions are a necessity in our culture. We're not, can't be, most of us can't possibly be self-sufficient. But our use of these possessions and our attitude about their importance is our choice. And it's a choice we can make with the awareness our faith in Jesus commits us to show our care for the poor. Perhaps, as you gather with family or friends, consider these questions. Would it be possible to list all our possessions? Are there things in our house that we no longer need or use? What might we do with these things? How does this make you feel? Think about an action that would help you and your family and friends to show its commitment to the poor. And at this point, I'm just going to read the peace prayer of St. Francis, because I think that is helpful. Lord, make us instruments of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. O Divine Master, grant that we may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love, for it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Jesus doesn't want to make it difficult for us to follow him, but he does want us to follow him with our whole heart. Sometimes this requires that we make changes in our lives to be his disciples. Imagine that Jesus asked you this question. What would Jesus ask of you? What might you do as a first step towards giving your whole self to Jesus? Perhaps we can ask Jesus to help us to give ourselves completely being his disciple. And the wonderful prayer of St. Ignatius of Loyola. Take, Lord, and receive all my liberty, my memory, my understanding, and my entire will. All I have and call my own. You have given all to me, what you will. Give me only your love.